Hello, Mr. Sanjay Dixit. Actually, thank you very much for enlightening us with your views about Hindu-Pakistan. My name is Imtiaz Ahmed, and basically, I was very interested to know what you actually were going to talk about this. And I joined late, so I just came to know about one thing which you actually talked about Islam, and it said that no Muslim can go to heaven. If the whole world remains, doesn't become Muslim. So I want to know the source from where you derive this first.
I'm talking about Pakistan.
No, you actually, during the talk, course of your talk, you mentioned this thing. So do you have any source of
Yeah, the Hadith of Nasai.
what does it say? I actually I
Yeah,
haven't come across
that is
such a.
the Nasai Hadith, which is very popular in Pakistan. But India, it is treated as what is called Jaif, that is inconsistent. But in Pakistan, the Nasai Hadith, which is exactly what I said, is very popular. And it is part of the establishment discourse. I discussed it with a lot of people. In India, they do not regard the Nasai Hadith as consistent. As you know, the Hadiths are consistent and inconsistent. So this is what is called a grade 4 Hadith. But in Pakistan, it is very, very popular.
Okay.
If you just try and put it on YouTube, you'll find any number of Pakistani mullahs talking about it.
Second thing is the write-up which was about the program. It was something mentioned it actually gave the impression that Hindus should actually be belligerent and should destroy evil forces. So what do you mean by evil forces here? First. Second thing is, since you are actually talking about the resurgence of Hindu Pakistan, or quote unquote Hindu Pakistan, I am a Muslim and my genealogy is Indian, right? Probably my ancestors were sometimes back Hindus, some many generations back Hindus and all. So how do you now, in the present scenario where there are a lot of atrocities on fellow Indian Hindus called Dalits? So how do you accommodate those kind of people in that so that no further alienation of Hindu population happens? Because unless and until you are not willing to share power to those people, I think this is not going to happen. So I would like to know your take on this. Thank you.
Now, I think this is a little problematic because you mentioned only one category. And you mentioned Hindus and you mentioned Dalits. Now, this is a discourse which is basically flawed. Why it is flawed? Let me get back again to the foundation because I was talking about foundation. There is a difference between foundational principles and there is a difference between behavior. I haven't even discussed the behavioral part of it. So doctrines and behaviors can differ. I have only talked about doctrines. Okay? You are talking about a behavioral aspect. Now you said that Hindus and a lot of atrocities on Dalits. You use the word Hindus, right? I just like to inform you, in the last 3 months, there have been at least 36 violent incidents involving Muslims and Dalits, which have not been highlighted. So there is also a flawed discourse which is going on, which wants to create this difference between what is called Dalits and Indians. And somehow some of our Muslim friends are very active in this. Not talking about you. How they do it, I find this talk on TV, a lot of people, some guys called Mehmood Paracha and all that, they come and they say that. What are they talking about? There was a power sharing between Muslims and Dalits in 1946. What happened? This is the one recorded instance of power sharing between Muslims and Dalits in the Indian subcontinent. What happened to that? What happened to Jyotirindranath Mandal? That poor fellow was not allowed in the cabinet meeting. The law minister of Pakistan was not allowed in the cabinet meetings that was discussing the war with India in 1947, saying, "You are a Hindu, you cannot be allowed." He ran away from East Pakistan, died unnoticed, ignored in Calcutta. And those very Dalits whom he had aligned with the Muslim League in 1946 for Muslim League to win a complete majority in Bengal, which actually facilitated the partition of Bengal. Otherwise, there would have been no partition of Bengal because Muslim League would not have got the majority. And those very Nam Shudras and Rajbanshis, they were hounded out from Bangladesh, because of which that infamous Nehru-Liaquat Act was brought about. Who were the people who were being massacred and thrown out? All of them were Dalits. And as far as Hindus are concerned, Mayawati has been chief minister 4 times. So don't talk about this power sharing business. Okay? Thank you.
Can you, I'm sorry, I just wanted to complete this question. You mentioned some hadith which is very popular in Pakistan, not popular in India. Is it some sort of
Pakistan's foundation is that taqwa, iman, jihad fi sabilillah. So how do they justify jihad fi sabilillah?
But is that popular among all other Muslim nations? And is it a form of, I don't know, just hiding away takiyah or something in India?
Let me come to this. So there are several sects in Islam. And there are several subsects. There are Hanafis. India is mostly among Sunnis, it is Hanafis. Then there are Shafi'is. There are Malikis and there are Wahhabis. So, it is very popular among Wahhabis. Wahhabis are basically, the sect is basically Hanbalis. And in Saudi Arabia, it is followed, though Wahhabis can be across the sects. Because that basically, what they mean, the purity of the first few caliphs, that kind of pure state should be there. So that can be there across, but mainly the Hanbalis, the Wahhabis, the ISIS types, they are the ones who believe in this, because this also, it doesn't stop at this conquest of India. It also goes, if you look at the hadith which the ISIS is following, then it also goes to the final battle at Dabiq, the place called Dabiq on Turkey-Syria border. It says that the final battle, I hope you know this, about Dabiq, no? I've actually written a short story on that. So the final battle where will happen at Dabiq, and it is there that Dajjal will come, the Christ will come, and the Prophet will come, and that is the day of last judgment will happen, and then everybody will be given their appointed place, and of course the kafirs will necessarily go to hell. Right or wrong?
As far as Dabiq is concerned, I don't know much about it, but if you talk about that, yes, Antichrist, which is Dajjal, the emergence of Dajjal will be there. And there will be reincarnation sort of thing to Prophet Jesus Christ, which you call. So according to our belief, Muslim belief, that Jesus Christ is still alive, right? Contrary to the beliefs of Christians. And that kind of a thing will happen according to our understanding, our belief. As far as the thing you have actually talked about, that Zaif hadith. Zaif means weak hadith. So yeah, weak
means inconsistent.
So weak hadith,
chain is not complete.
Yeah, chain is not complete, or the person concerned is not reliable. So that kind of a hadith is put into a different category. The main hadith are Bukhari and Muslim and Mishkat and some sort.
Yeah, I know. Bukhari is one, number one. Muslim is number two.
So these kind of things are there. But like, you know, these are beliefs, and these are not just beliefs of Muslims. These are beliefs of even Christians as well.
I know.
Even Jews as well. So because these are religions which are called Abrahamic religions. So
the Christians won't allow Muslims to go to heaven. Yeah, Muslims so won't that allow kind Christians of, to go so to the heaven. Whole, the, and both of them together will not allow anyone else to go to heaven.
So the whole, you know, the change of geopolitics, like what is happening in Israel and America and many other Western countries, all these things are actually, you know, in the background. And people are, you know, getting, you know, what you can say is getting suspicious or being, are getting, you know, what you can say, fearful of other people, other religions. So that kind of thing. And I was very pretty amused, actually, you know, when I was coming to, I was willing to listen. I was willing to know from you that you mentioned in the write-up leading up to the description of the program. It was a belligerent kind of a note. So I just wanted to know what all people are need to be annihilated or destroyed or so that kind of a thing. I would like to know from you.
Samam sarveshu bhuteshu. Tishtantam Parameshwaram. Samoham sarva bhuteshu. Name dveshyosti na priya. I am equal in all beings. I do not dislike anyone, and I do not love anyone. That is the basic philosophy. Okay. Please sit down.
I was sitting with Ahmadiyya.
Sorry?
Ahmadiyya. Ahmadiyya is a subset of Muslim.
Ahmadiyya.
So they said in Pakistan that about 25% of Hindus, now they are 2%. Now question is, who is Muslim? This Sunni says Shias are not Muslim, Ahmadiyya are not Muslim, and many are not Muslims, and they debunk them. And they really, and one Shia friend, they said, what you are talking, that Sunnis have burnt your mandirs and all that. They have done more aspects to us than what they have done to you. Then who are the Muslim? Because everybody claims I am the pure Muslim.
Land of the pure.
The Boko Haram says, I am the pure. ISIS, I am the pure. Then this ISI says, then Al-Qaeda, then Taliban, everybody says, I am the purest, and all their puppets.
I'll tell you something.
What is exactly the, who is the Muslim?
I'll tell you this little story. You see, Muhammad Ali Jinnah was a Shia. Okay? Yeah, I mean, Ismaili is a sect of Shia. It's a Shia sect. You can be Ismaili, you can be Jafri, you can be Bora. Who was his first foreign minister? Zafarullah Khan. What was he? He was an Ahmadi. Who were the people among Muslims who opposed partition? Deobandis. Including Maududi. Maududi. Jamaat-e-Islami founder, Abul Ala Maududi, he opposed partition. Reasons were different. The targets were the same. The reasons were different. So, Shia, Ahmadi, and the major sect of Sunnis, that is Barelvi, they were all in the forefront of partition movement, especially the wealthier among them, because the franchise at that time was limited to those who were either landowners or income taxpayers. What is the status in Pakistan today? All of them are called kafirs. By whom? Devandis. The Devandis, they aligned with what is called the Ahle Hadith people, and they call everybody else as kafir. The Shia is kafir. The Ismaili, Aga Khan, they are all kafirs. Ahmadi, of course, they are written in the constitution, in the 1974 constitution, that they cannot be Muslims. Now, all these people, they were in the forefront. So, I think you can say karma. So, they are reaping their karma there. So, this is the situation in Pakistan. So, Pakistan is the, what is called the fanaticism about purity of Islam has led them to this situation. And with the motto of the Pakistan army being what it is, it's only going to go down. It's only going to get worse. We don't have to do much. Their inner contradictions are such that they will feast upon each other very soon. YouTube pe ek padhiyega aap, is a very very poignant talk. 10 minute ka talk. The Kafir Factory. I know some of them might have watched it. So, ek wahan ka ek koi literary banda hai, wo is pe ye ek takreer karta hai, the Kafir Factory. How we create kafirs. How Pakistani hai. How Pakistan creates kafir. The Kafir Factory karke YouTube pe suniyega zarur. Then you will realize what this fanaticism has led them to. My problem in India is, let's see, the general people are not into it. But if you go to the majority of clerics and maulanas, they have the same idea. I don't have to tell you any proof. You listen to what is going on the TV and what they say every day, day in and day out. What happened to Waris Pathan? The guy, Waris Pathan, he lectures on secularism every day on the TV. Oh, Galpati Bappa Moria bol diya. So, sare ke sare Maulana uske piche pad gaye. And ultimately, he had to apologize. So, this concept of purity, if it taken to its fanatical extreme, it will destroy those very people who indulge in this.
Khilafat movement.
I was Mahatma Gandhi
for Khilafat, supporting Khilafat movement.
Why?
But he can tell. I never understood myself. I mean, how can any person who talks of ahimsa of the extreme kind, ahimsa of action, how can a person support that kind of a movement? What was the difference between the Caliphate movement and the ISIS movement? It's the same. The foundation is the same. The theory is the same. Baghdadi also wants to bring in Caliphate. Ali brothers also want to bring in Caliphate. In fact, our great Maulana Azad also has done a lot of takrir in favor of Khilafat. So if you think that I am with Mahatma Gandhi on that, sorry, I am not. I am yet to understand. If it was a purely politically motivated move, it was a disastrous move. It only strengthened the resolve of people like Muhammad Iqbal. Ultimately, what happened? The Ali brothers dissed Mahatma Gandhi, which had to happen. Anyway, can we have some other people asking questions?
Thank you very much. It was very enlightening to listen to very detailed analysis of some of the concepts. I'm a scientist, so I look at some of these things from that perspective. And I have watched situations, maybe some historical. So I find Islam or Muhammad Sahab reacting to certain situations at a certain time. Just like Bhagwan Buddha reacted to certain things at a certain time. Bhagwan Mahavir reacted to certain things at certain times. So when you have a reaction in which you really want to disrupt the, whatever the society is, I'm assuming that was a right time for Prophet Muhammad to do certain things. And maybe in a war, you have certain exceptions made. My problem is that I'm a chemist. If I used 124-year-old, I have a book, chemistry book, which is 124-year-old, and I try to explain, no matter how, I become creative in explaining, it just has changed. It's not going to be explainable. Problem is that some certain terms, certain tools, I'm just talking about in science, that were a long time ago. I mean, there is a idea of Pushpak Biman. There is a particular description of Pushpak Biman. There are 72 kind of things that were used, and hardly people know what those were. Nobody knows what those were. Maybe there was a Pushpak Biman, but if only we knew what those. I mean, today we know what calcium is, what zinc is. But let's say 1,000 years from now, nobody knows what calcium zinc is. They wouldn't mean anything. So I think, from science perspective, and I say this in this context, particularly in India, because India is the only country that has in its own constitution, Article 51A, saying that the society will develop its scientific temper. Why don't we use something like that? Not only to critique, of course, Islam or Christianity, I mean, this idea of who can go to heaven and who will compete. I guarantee everybody to heaven. I just need $99. $99 per person. Come to me, money back guarantee. If you don't get to heaven, come back, I will give it to you.
If you don't go to heaven, they can return the money.
I'll give you two times. If you can convince your relatives that they can come back and convince that you visited them.
I think
them.
In the US, they are even selling spaces in the
area. Yes, they are selling spaces. I think that's where I got this idea. This guy is making $20 million a year by selling plots on Moon. 67, he sells 67.5 acres. Exact. And gives you a map and everything. What I'm trying to say, so that's one aspect. The other aspect is particularly violent in Islam particularly. And it has been done in Christianity also, but mostly in Islam. It's really a biological target. They use certain phrases, certain items, like, the 72 virgins. And also, even in here, if you don't go there, you can capture them wherever you can have them. Basically, it's a hormonal appeal. It's a certain groups of people who will be attracted to that. There is an age when that happens. So we could use, I'm saying that the second reason why we should use science, maybe we should say Islam is a great idea. It should be only applicable to 50 or older. You can't, just like we say, you cannot marry below 18. You simply say that you cannot appeal this thing to certain group of people. And then that will perhaps solve the, at least will address scientifically. Number three, the last point I want to make, is that a system. I started with the system. When you create a system, then people follow it, and then they try to interpret, reinterpret, and do all kind of things. No one don't understand it, what those circumstances were. I'm simply saying Prophet Muhammad probably had perfectly good reason to do whatever he did at that time. But it's not replicable at this point. No matter what we are all created by, like you said, everybody is great and everybody is part of the God or Brahma or Ishwar. So we cannot have differences. From Hindu's perspective, we cannot have that idea that somebody is devil or demon or whatever. The point is that we have a system now created, which is a Western system. And unfortunately, it comes from Semitic or Abrahamic spiritual idea. They have Trinity, which is the God, the Son or the Prophet, and the Holy Ghost. We have equivalent to that, what we consider as the executive branch and legislative and judicial branch and people. The reason I say this, because if you really see the functioning of the society, it works exactly like that. And that is a system came from Western world.
Can
which
you please
we think,
keep it a little short?
Yeah.
So I'm losing track of the question.
Okay. So my point is that if we could use the science as an argument and the system that we have created to alter the system, make it more like what is Hindus, which believe direct justice because they have direct contact with the God or the Ishwar. That is the question.
Science. I mean, I cannot disagree with what you're proposing. Certainly, then you ask something in the context of Islam. So, I will tell you that the advancement of science during the 9th to 10th century, especially during the period of the Abbasids, Abbasi jisko bolte, during the period of Abbasids, was very high. And what the West has got today is knowledge, a lot of it transported from India through Baghdad. There used to be a house of wisdom during the period of Abbasid period in Baghdad, where they used to get knowledge from India, translate it in their own language, Persian and Arabic, and they used to acknowledge the source, something that the Christians never did. When this knowledge was being translated and also being transmitted elsewhere, including Egypt, you must have heard of that story of burning of the library of Alexandria by the Christians. So that was the start of the Christian Dark Ages. So when this was all happening in Baghdad, the Christians were in Dark Ages. They were totally bereft of any scientific knowledge, because over here a lot of scientific churn was happening. There was a full school of science going on in Baghdad. There were three clear strains within Islam: the conservative, the spiritual, and the devotional. It was only after the 10th century that the spiritual strain was killed off, and the conservative and the devotional, they got together, Al-Ghazali and later on Ibn Taymiyyah. These people, they got together and they completely finished off the spiritual part, and most of it, and after the conquest of Spain by the Christians, it simply disappeared. Iqbal did try to revive it. You read his Shikwa, Jawab-e-Shikwa. There's a lot of spirituality there, but then he couldn't carry it forward. He wanted what is called Ijtihad. Ijtihad is reform. So that talk of Ijtihad died down in about 10th, 11th century in Islam. And that was the time when the Islamic Dark Ages began. Whereas after the conquest of Spain, what happened was that the library of Toledo, where a lot of these translated works were housed, one of the popes had the wisdom not to burn that library. And it is from there that all the advancements of Christian sciences begin. But this is all part of the history. This is all part of the recorded history. But now everybody acknowledges this. I think even in the West, even now, Manchester University came out with a paper where they acknowledged that calculus was actually from India. And without the infinite series, there could have been no calculus. West did not even have the concept of zero till the beginning of the 15th century. And how miraculous that in the 15th century they got zero, and within the 15th century Newton came out with all his advanced mathematics. These are all things that we need to consider, and of course a lot of research is now going on and things are all coming out. I mean, even today I was reading an article by Dr. Subhash Kak, where he discusses the Vaisheshik Sutras and the laws of motion which are described by Kanad and by Newton. Uncanny similarity, absolutely uncanny. How can it be? And how can it be when the Jesuits were here from the 13th, 14th centuries, taking away everything, transporting from here, and everything was being transported from Toledo? The Arabs had explicitly recognized. Every translation which was done from Indian sources has been recognized by the Arabs. Not so by the West. That is the dishonesty. So, while I agree with you, it's not that the Islam was always in the dark ages. What they call the golden age of Islam was characterized by a lot of scientific advancement, lot of literary advancement. It is when the conservatives and the Sufis, they prevailed and they completely killed off the spiritual strain. And all these, what is called the fanatical zeal completely overwhelmed them. It is then the decline began. Baghdad's sack, I think 1258. The sack of Baghdad in 1250 is a direct result of that decline.
Yes.
Can I just like take 1 minute?
Yeah, sure, please. Many minutes.
Just wanted to add two things. There was a discussion just now about the resurrection of the Christ and Mehdi coming back. So I just wanted Imam Mehdi coming back. The Muslims believe that Mehdi will come.
That's the Shia belief.
No, actually it's a Muslim belief that he will come. I just wanted to add that there is one sect among Muslims which is called the Ahmadi.
And we discussed that, no?
Yeah, I just wanted to make one point clear. Ahmadis believe that he already came.
Yeah, I know.
He was the Ahmadi, head. Yes. And the other thing is that there may not be a mention of 72 hoors in Quran, but there is a mention of how the hoors will look and how the ghilman will look. There is physical explanation of how they will appear. So if you are saying that there is no mention of 72, maybe that was present in some of the hadiths.
We have a full menu of hadiths to choose from. Yeah, you choose whichever you like.
There's a whole lot of detail of how these hoors will look, and that is later, like, there are three, that the Trinity of Islam has Siratul Nabi in it as well. And there is a lot of description which is not mentioned in Quran, and maybe a lot of Indian Muslims don't read about it and they're not told about it. It doesn't mean that
Quran
it doesn't
cannot
exist.
Be read on its own.
Yeah,
Quran
it has to be read along with Siratul Nabi.
With the exegesis, and the exegesis is Hadith and the Sirat. So, reading Quran all by itself is a very difficult task.
Yeah, I think anyway, Muslims of India need to read Islam themselves to understand it better, because then only they can argue.
I recommend to everybody, read Quran and Shariat. I agree with you.
Yes, I am Mukesh Sapra. Your lecture was really wonderful.
Thank you, sir.
I would like to ask my question in Hindi.
हाँ, बिल्कुल.
आपने कृष्ण और गोपेश्वर जो किताब लिखी है,
जी जी,
काफी चर्चा हुई अखबारों में भी, मैंने भी इसका देखा,
लाइक
में भी जिक्र है.
जी.
तो मेरा सीधा सवाल ये है कि क्या आपको लगता है कि आज के जमाने में कृष्ण की दोबारा से जरूरत है, क्योंकि कृष्ण के जमाने में कोई हिंदू मुस्लिम नहीं था और अब जो इतने कंसेप्ट आ गए दलित का.
आपने पढ़ी क्या किताब?
नहीं, मैंने उसके राइट ऑफ पढ़े हैं.
नहीं, राइट ऑफ नहीं, आप किताब पढ़िए, आपको मिल जाएगा. उसमें भी एक कुटिल धर्म है.
तो जैसे आर्य समाज के स्वामी सदानंद थे, उन्होंने सन 1918 में दलितों धार सभा बनाई थी और कई लोगों को उन्होंने, हजारों को उन्होंने वापस हिंदू धर्म में लिया. जैसे अभी ये इम्तियाज कह रहे थे कि मेरे फादर या फोर फादर या ऊपर हिंदू रहे होंगे, और मैं भी ऐसे 10 लोगों को जानता हूँ जिनके जो फोर फादर थे देवर और हिंदू, इवन आई नो सम क्रिश्चियंस जिनके सब वो हिंदू थे. तो ऐसा क्यों ना कंपेन चलाया जाए कि सारे अपने आप को ओरिजिनलिटी भी आ जाए, उसको नाम हिंदू मत दीजिए, दे शुड बी कॉल्ड भारतीय या मूल भारतीय. तो वो
दैट इज आउटसाइड द स्कोप ऑफ दिस डिस्कशन.
दूसरा क्वेश्चन ये मेरा कि जब हम हिंदू पाकिस्तान की बात करते हैं, तो इसका मतलब इंडिया तब मजबूत होगा जब बहुसंख्यक मजबूत होगा, बट वी टॉक अबाउट और रीजंस और सेक्स, तो इसलिए वी हैव टू चेंज आवर कंसेप्ट.
I cannot disagree with you on this.
Sir, आपने कहा था कि थोड़ा सा हम शायद सॉफ्टन अप कर देते हैं कि पाकिस्तान को ब्लेम करके कि इस्लाम कट्टरवाद वहां पर रहता है और इंडिया में शायद नहीं है. मुझे बार बार ये आज भी थोड़ी सी फीलिंग आ रही थी.
देखिए मुशरिक और मुनाफिक, तो ये मुशरिक इज वन हु प्रैक्टिसेस शिर्क. मुशरिक और मुनाफिक और मुर्ताद, हाँ मुर्ताद, मुशरिक, मुनाफिक, मुर्ताद, ये तीन चीज़ें जो हैं ये बहुत ही ख़राब मानी जाती हैं. और जो कट्टर लोग हैं जो भी हैं, दे यू कैन ड्रॉ एनीथिंग आउट ऑफ, यू कैन से एनीथिंग एंड यू कैन जस्टिफाई आउट ऑफ द शरीयत. And there is a full strain which says that anybody who practices any of these is wajibul qatl. Ye thinking hai, nobody can deny it.
Ye mainstream Quranic thinking hai. Aap
usko karne ki zarurat kya hai? Proof dekh lijiye na, YouTube pe kitne videos chal rahe hain. Wo Zakir Nayak ko bhaga diya, wo kam se kam sach to bolta tha. ये जो हमारे मौलाना यहाँ बैठे हुए हैं, खासतौर से आपके बरेलवी वाले, ये तो सच भी नहीं बोलते. आई रोट एन आर्टिकल ऑन जाकिर नायक, एक पीस मैंने लिखा था जाकिर नायक पे, आई थिंक आइदर स्वराज और इंडिया फैक्ट्स में. एंड आई सेड दैट आप किसी भी मौलाना को, जाकिर नायक को क्रिटिसाइज करते हुए सुन लीजिए, क्या बोलेगा कि इसको ये कहने का हक नहीं है. वो ये नहीं कहेगा कि गलत कह रहा है. इसके पीछे भी एक, मैं आपको समझाता हूं, दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर एवरीबॉडी टू अंडरस्टैंड, पीपल डोंट अंडरस्टैंड. आई डोंट नो वेदर इम्तियाज जी ऑल्सो नोज दिस और नॉट. इन द वहाबीज और द हनबली सेक्ट, among the Sunnis, the four sects, as I told you, Hanbali, Shafi'i, and Maliki, and Hanfi. Hanfi is what we have in this continent. There's a concept of what is called taqleed. Correct? Taqleed means that anything that you say or you explain, any fiqha or any verse, it has to be done by a person suitably authorized. And there's a whole system of, the whole system of giving that authority to certain people. That is why you have these your muftis and this and that. Wo zakir hanbalis mein taqleed nahi hai. दे आर वॉट इज कॉल्ड गैर मुकल्लिद. तो जाकिर जो है वो गैर मुकल्लिद है. ही डजंट हैव एनी अथॉरिटी, बट बिकॉज ही इज प्रीचिंग वहाबिज्म, ही डजंट हैव टू. सो एवरीबॉडी हियर, वेदर इज बरेलवी और इज देवबंदी, एनीबॉडी, आप जाकिर हुसैन, जाकिर नायक का मुझको कोई सा भी क्रिटिसिज्म बता दीजिए जो इसके अलावा हो. He has no authority to say this. And what is this? This is a terrible hypocrisy. I question them. I question a lot of Maulanas on their face. Why don't you say that he is saying wrong? नहीं कह सकते क्योंकि जो कह रहा है सही कह रहा है.
This reminds me of a very beautiful quote by Kinra Delst, one of our lectures only. He said कि औरंगजेब को आप सब लोग गाली देते रहते हो, बट यू शुड स्टॉप क्रिटिसाइजिंग औरंगजेब और मेकिंग हिम अ डेमन. इट्स एक्चुअली द डॉक्ट्रिन व्हिच ही फॉलोड व्हिच इज द प्रॉब्लम. इट इज नॉट औरंगजेब हु इज द प्रॉब्लम, द डॉक्ट्रिन इज द प्रॉब्लम.
आजकल मुस्लिम और दलित गठजोड़ की बात हो रही है. महमूद प्राचा जब भी टीवी पे आते हैं पीछे अम्बेडकर की फोटो लगी होती है. मैं ये आपसे जानना चाह रहा हूँ कि जो नहीं, देयर इज अ क्वेश्चन सर,
मैंने महमूद प्राचा को कई बार पूछा है ट्विटर पे, जवाब नहीं देते हो।
नहीं मैं आपसे नहीं, दलित मुस्लिम गठजोड़ के ऊपर तो टाइम्स ऑफ इंडिया जितने न्यूज़पेपर हैं सभी में आर्टिकल आते हैं। मैं मेरा सिर्फ ये पूछना है कि दलित और विशेष रूप से अम्बेडकर तो बुद्ध थे, अब वो महात्मा बुद्ध की पूजा करते हैं, क्या वो काफिर नहीं है? अगर वो काफिर है, अगर वो काफिर है तो मुस्लिम को क्लैरिफाई करना चाहिए, महमूद प्राचा को क्लैरिफाई करना चाहिए।
दिस इज जस्ट पॉलिटिकल पोस्चरिंग,
व्हाट विल बी देयर पोजीशन इफ देयर इज अ मुस्लिम स्टेट।
दिस इज पॉलिटिकल पोस्चरिंग, मैंने आपको बता दिया ना, मैंने आपको बंगाल का एग्जांपल बता तो दिया। हाँ बोलिए बोलिए बिल्कुल।
I am RVS Mani. I have already written a book on myth of Hindu terror. I have already written a book. I have exposed how the political posturing has repeatedly said POK. We were saying that on the parliament, we were answering that POK, Pak-based terror groups are perpetuating terror in India, and in political posturing, Digvijay Singh, incumbent home ministers kept on saying that there is a Hindu terror. And some narratives were perpetuated, and the original perpetrator, say Arif Kasmani, had taken a supari from ISI to do the Samjhota blast, and he still escaped. And our own fellows ultimately went through the incarceration, and later on were acquitted by the court. This is a fact I have captured with records and reliable, publicly available documents. So that is one part of it about the Dalit and Muslim combination. You see the position which is happening to Dalits from Punjab, 47, who were settled in Kashmir, Srinagar, still they cannot go for any other job excepting the job of scavenging. But that is Valmiki, that is scavenging. Nothing else they are entitled to under the Article 370 and 35A. So that is the position. Whenever, so that position is clear, your question stands answered, that if it's a larger Islamic state, the position of the status of the Dalits or whatever is going to be, that stands already answered in that. About this Imtiazi, about the Nafisa Hadith, again, the foot soldiers who were radicalized through the Pak money were, in fact, several places they were brought into a group called Ahle Hadith.
Yeah, Ahle Hadith.
Ahle Hadith, basically. And they were given a note that Indian Ahle Hadith. So that also stands established. It's all a matter of public record. Thank you.
No, I'll just add to what you're saying, since you brought in that question of Kashmir. You see, in Rajasthan, we deal with a large number of Hindus who migrate out of Pakistan because of the atrocities that are being inflicted on them. And about 99% of them are Dalits. So this artificial construct of Muslim Dalit empathy is just a hogwash, just political posturing and nothing else. I told you, I have asked Mahmood Pracha, who puts up that photograph of Ambedkar behind him when he talks on TV, so many times he never answers because he doesn't have an answer.
Sir, so where I'm coming from is that I listen to a lot of these speeches by Muslim liberals in the West, and what they say is that jihad is not interpreted as simply as you put it. What it means is violence against people who are opposing Islam and not necessarily just going and invading.
You see, that's why I always quote the Pakistan Army's motto, because jihad fi sabilillah has a specific meaning, and that is a violent meaning. If you use only the term jihad, it can be interpreted in 10 different ways. But jihad fi sabilillah cannot be interpreted in any different way. Yes, please.
This is the first question that was asked to this fellow Hindu brothers, Dalits, you know. I have been listening to a lot of these kind of talks, particularly in Tata Institute and, you know, so-called secular liberal. JNU, not so much, Tata Institute.
Jadavpur.
Been a part of, studied there.
IIT Madras.
No, but, you know, what I noticed that, you know, there are four or five people usually placed at strategic corners, and they will ask these very similar questions. Over the last 10 years, I'm hearing. Maybe no, 7 years.
Are you so blaming India's way? I don't think so.
No. I just wanted to know. I was at a Netra Tantra workshop at Himachal recently. About just this morning, I came to Delhi. And I just met this person from Kashmir. He is now in Jammu. He's a Kashmiri Pandit and one of the higher echelons kind of judge in the UPSC. And he shockingly told me that 98% of the Kashmiri Pandits are not there. They've moved to Jammu. This ghettoization that has happened. And in Jammu now, there are these Rohingyas who are being settled to even oust them out from there. Why do these compassionate liberal seculars not talk about, you know, the your own fellow Indians?
They disarm you by saying Vasudha.
No, this was just a thought. I thought everybody knows who I'm talking about because I constantly hear this.
These are all facts which are common knowledge.
So, you know, just I wish they take up because are we children of a lesser God?
Yes. No, I agree with you. These are all facts which are there in the in public knowledge, and there isn't even a counter to them.
Let's just add to what ma'am said. You're right, 98% of the Kashmiri Pandits have moved. And I don't think so, that's a bad thing. There's a worst thing which has happened is their ethnic cleansing. Now, if anybody has to go back, they don't know where their roots are. While government is doing all of that, they should be moved back, I don't think so anybody will go back. Now, second thing, now what you're saying in Jammu, they are being moved out of Jammu. You said one part of it, then another part of it is, now if anything happens in Jammu, I just want to ask who's in minority in Jammu? Is it a Kashmiri Pandit or it is a Muslim? Now if anything happens in Jammu, the curfew is only enforced when anything happens to a Muslim. Why? Because they're a minority. It's the fact here is Kashmiri Pandit is in a minority. If anything happens to him, there's no curfew. I'm absolutely. So I'm saying is who is minority? So that is a dichotomy. So I just want to add.
I will tell you what the dichotomy is. This I have because I generally confront mullahs, and they have started avoiding me because they realize that I have a bit of study of both the Islamic history as well as the Islamic scriptures. So I can, you know, the problem with them is that if you quote a verse from Quran, they can't even say no. I would advise everybody to do that.
It was that time. This time. I had actually a conversation with somebody from Deoband. He lives in Toronto called, I forget his name, he's a Mufti from Deoband. And I've actually tried to have a conversation.
What they tell you and what they go, ask Tariq Fateh, he keeps posting those videos from Canada.
Yeah.
What they tell to the congregation and what they tell you.
This book actually states very beautifully the Banu Qurayza incident, where the Prophet...
So, Avaran?
Avaran, yes.
Yeah, I have this.
900
book.
Men were beheaded and thrown into a pit. I countered him with this point that, you know...
How Banu Qurayza is again a well-known incident.
I didn't know till I read this book.
Yeah, it's a well-known incident.
So, I mean, they twist everything. Everything is about some twisting. You counter them in, will I go to hell? Will Gandhi go to hell? You know, there
of
is
course he will go to hell.
We cannot judge. We cannot, only Allah will judge. Okay, but tell me, what does the Quran say?
Of course he will go to hell. Gandhi will go to hell, Swami Vivekananda will go to hell, you and I will go to hell, everybody will go to hell. We are all part of our hell. Let us make it heaven. Again, I've written a piece on this, Kashmir. There's a two-part piece which is written, I think, 2 years back or something. And I've traced the history only from 1932. So I could go back to the 13th century. That 370 is actually India's tribute to the two nation theory. Article 370 is India's tribute to two nation theory. Otherwise, there is absolutely no justification. Why? A separate status should be given to Jammu and Kashmir. We all know the history, you know, how Ambedkar had opposed it, and it was Jawaharlal Nehru's insistence on which this happened. Anyway, let that be. I have confronted a lot of mullahs with this question. Okay, they say that we are all Indians and we put the nation before everything else. If you are Indian and if you believe in the integrity of India and the Indian nation, you believe in the constitution, have you heard one person ever opposing Article 370? Why do some political parties, the so-called quote-unquote secular parties, keep supporting Article 370? What is there in the Muslim vote which forces secular parties to support 370? Well, these are hard questions. How many? There must be, of course, there will always be some. But tell me one Maulana or Mullah, if you can, please, who opposes Article 370 and says that Kashmir should be fully integrated into India. If you have your heart with India, if you say that you respect Indian constitution, Indian constitutionalism, you respect the nation, why is it that not one person ever opposes 370? It is because of the doctrine. It is because the two nation theory still lives in the minds. And I'm saying this openly. Anybody who wants to refute it, then he has to first show to me that he has demanded the 370 be scrapped. I'm with you.
सर आपके हिसाब से कैसा होना चाहिए था विभाजन के बाद का भारत ताकि हिंदुओं को दूसरे दर्जे का नागरिक ना रहना पड़े शासन तंत्र में क्या होना चाहिए था जिसके हिसाब से आपके ब्यूरोक्रेसी में
मुझे तो नहीं लगता हिंदू दूसरे दर्जे के नागरिक हैं कुछ पार्ट्स में हो सकते
हैं पार्ट्स में आप मानते हैं तो वो तो आप मान ही रहे हैं फिर
इंडियन एजुकेशन सिस्टम सी इंडियन एजुकेशन सिस्टम was affected definitely under the Mughal rules, and that was affected because the temples which were the seat of learning were destroyed in large numbers. That is a fact. But as far as giving education in their own system is concerned, that started happening only after Macaulay.
Article 25 to 26 to 30, all of them are enabling the minority institutions to pursue or including state funds, draw their state fund, and minority designated minority institutions can propagate their own traditional religious knowledge. But the same is debarred for a majority, for which we have now taken up a Hindu charter of demand. That's a different story, but we are going to take it. And ironically, the first person who flagged this issue was Syed Shahabuddin. In 1995, he moved a private member bill, and which again lapsed. Subsequent, recently, Mr. Dr. Satyapal Singh had raised the same issue for constitutional amendment. He raised it in 2016. We are pursuing it to make it as a government bill. Rahul Diwan is one of the pioneers of that movement. Ruchi Sood is also there. There are many of us in that movement also.
I am aware of that.
Right. So that is the reason that this constitutional amendment will be one of the path breaking, because see now, even now, one of these provisions have been very interpreted in a very hackneyed manner. No state can impose taxes on the institutions, but existing taxes, they are still continuing under the Hindu endowment, religious endowment. There are several such infirmities in those five articles which we are trying to correct. So that's the movement we have started. I'm sure you are aware of it, but that is including your concern. We have started a movement. We are trying to correct the infirmities. You can join and support, lend your support also. Please, thank you.
So 30 actually mentions words minorities instead of all communities, all denominations. And it's called the negative Gangotri of the Temple Endowments Act. The temple endowments, government does not interfere with churches or mosques. With mosques, at least there is a waqf board. The churches, government does not touch. The DAV, which is Arya Samaj, cannot teach Arya Samaj literature. But there is no restriction.
I will give you a prescription within the RTE Act. If you pursue that, then you can have exactly what you want.
I mean, the source is 26 to 30.
The source is, of course, it is there. Have you, if you read the constitutional assembly debates, see, one of the, when we talk about the constitution, the problem is even honorable judges are not reading the constitutional assembly debates. When I read some of the judgments, I cannot take name. I don't want to be hauled up for contempt. But the point is that the so-called erudite judgments being written do not have a single passage quoted from the Constituent Assembly debates, but they will quote from Rousseau, they will quote from Voltaire, they will quote from Hobbes and Locke and Kant and everybody else, but you will not find a single passage quoted from the Constituent Assembly debates. Where does the Constitution give the power? There are a lot of things which have happened due to interpretations. When our founding fathers gave so much power to the courts, they were looking at people like Patanjali Shastri and Vivian Bose, who were scholars, great scholars of jurisprudence. Do we have those kind of people today? People who are just, you know, vacuous, flaunting of useless knowledge. I'll tell you something. This is again my personal, I've always been interested in law, especially constitutional law. And I used to love reading Supreme Court judgments. Some judgments are really good and scholarly. I stopped doing that in 2006. You can figure out. A lot of these distortions are due to interpretations. The Shirur Math judgment is a beautiful judgment. It's one of the most scholarly judgments ever written. But you say it doesn't apply. It doesn't apply. Simple. Why it doesn't apply? That is not explained. Because if you apply that judgment, then you cannot pass the judgment that you want to.
We spoke about doctrines and the history, the implications of doctrines and theology in present day. I am trying to understand the effect of theology, say, 30, 40 years ahead in the future. How do you tackle this? How do you speak with somebody who's not willing to speak or reason? How do you solve this fundamental problem? Because I
do not have a ready prescription, because behavioral aspects can be very complicated. That is why I generally try to confine myself to doctrines. But when you come to the behavioral aspects, there's too much of dynamic, and there are too much of interrelationships, and too much of complexities involved. How a particular set of behavioral relationship would go in a particular direction or a different direction. This is something very difficult to predict.